Shabbat Shalom. Have I not commanded you to be strong and courageous? This is what the Bible says in Joshua 1, verse 9. Here God says to Joshua to be strong and courageous. As a matter of fact, God repeats it 3 times in Joshua 1 alone. God repeats it 10 times to Moses and Joshua in the book of Deuteronomy and Joshua. Most of us probably read this as a motivation and encouragement for our life, a life which is not always easy. But is this what God means? Is this His intention? To motivate, to encourage us for our life? I don't think so. God told Joshua that he needed to be strong and very courageous to follow God instead of relying on himself. Because let's be honest, we all know that God has a plan for all of us in our life, right? But how many of us really follow this calling? It's much easier to make our own decisions, to rely on ourselves, to follow our own dreams, make our own decisions for our careers, right? It's more difficult to follow God's plan for our life because we want to be in control. And therefore, God told Joshua, I have an assignment for you, a calling, and it will not be easy. Therefore, I chose you, because I believe you are capable to do it. God assured Joshua his assignment based on 5 promises. His provision. Every place your foot will step, I've given to you as I promised to Moses. His power. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. His presence. Just as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. His providence. Be strong, courageous, to obey all the laws that Moses commanded you and do not turn from it. To the right, to the left, that you be successful wherever you go. His protection. Be strong, courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. It's all about being courageous. It's not about how big the dog is in the fight. It's about how big the fight is in the dog. God asked Joshua to be a leader of a group of several million difficult people in uncertain times, leaving the past, stepping into the promised land in a final season. But wait a minute, stepping into the promised land in a final season? Joshua is an ancient Old Testament story, right? But could it be that this old story is a foreshadow, full of beautiful details for us today? Could it be that Joshua's story is a roadmap for today, our near future? Let's find out and take a look at the story of Joshua. Who was this Joshua and this famous leader of Israel? Joshua was born in Egypt, belonged to the lineage of Ephraim, the descendant of Abraham. His real name wasn't Joshua, because Moses changed his name into Joshua. His real name was Hoshea, which means salvation. And in Hebrew, Jehoshua, which means Jehovah is salvation. But wait a minute. Is the name Joshua related to the name of Jesus? Yes. Joshua in Hebrew is Jeshua, the same name for Jesus. And Joshua in Greek is Jesus. That's interesting. Joshua in both Hebrew and also in Greek means Jesus. Joshua followed Moses for 40 years as his assistant. When Moses sent 12 spies to investigate Canaan as the promised land, Joshua was one of the 12. Joshua, together with Caleb from the tribe of Judah, they came back with positive, true faith news. The Joshua story really starts after the death of Moses, when God asked Joshua to continue where Moses left off, to cross over the Jordan River with all his people. And before crossing the Jordan River and take possession of the land as their inheritance, Joshua asked the people to prepare themselves for 2 days. And the people responded, all that you have commanded us, we will do. But wait a minute, where did we read this before in scripture? That people needed to prepare themselves for the 3rd day and responded, all you command, we will do. Mount Sinai, God's marriage proposal. Here God asked his people to prepare themselves for the 3rd day, his coming down. And all people responded, all that the Lord commands, we will do. That's interesting. Interesting especially the preparation of the 2 days for the 3rd day. Interesting, because 1 day stands for 1,000 years in the Bible. Jesus delays 2,000 years from his ascension until his 2nd return. Jesus also delayed 2 days when Lazarus died. Why? The same reason. It foreshadows Jesus' 2nd resurrection, his 2nd return, in 2 days, 2,000 years. The Bible tells us that during this 2-day preparation, Joshua sent out 2 people as spies. But wait a minute. Sent out 2 spies? Could it be that these 2 spies are the 2 witnesses during the Great Tribulation? I believe this will be Moses and Elijah to lastly warn the world about the 2nd coming of Jesus. Joshua sent 2 messengers to a city, Jericho, that was doomed to destruction, the world. The 2 spies went into Jericho and they came to the house of Rahab, a harlot, a prostitute. A prostitute? Yes. Many interpret this wrong because the same as with Samson, who also visited prostitutes, there was no wrongdoing visiting them. There were no sexual activities. In ancient days, harlots, prostitutes, were innkeepers, where strangers could spend the night. The king of Jericho heard about the 2 Jews visiting his land and asked Rahab to bring them to him. Rahab realized that there is something godly about these 2 men and she hides them on the roof, telling the king a lie that they already left before the main gates of the city closed. And then Rahab asked the 2 men to protect her and her family. Rahab is told to hang a piece of scarlet cord from her window, and both men warn her to keep all her family, including her friends, indoors. And then Rahab says, now then, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with my father's house and give me a sure sign that you will save my father and mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. And the 2 men said to her, our life for yours, even to death. How beautiful. This is the same what Jesus said. My life for yours. Like the parable of the good Samaritan, the Samaritan traded places. I walk and you ride my donkey. And he saved him. Interestingly, this happened on the way from Jerusalem to Jericho. There's nothing without a reason in the Bible. And then she let them down by a rope through the window. For a house was built into the city wall so that she lived in the wall. Here we read that Rahab let the 2 men escape and she advised them to flee to the mountains and hide there for 3 days. But wait a minute. Flee to the mountains and hide for 3 days? Where did we read this before in scripture? The Great Tribulation again, where Jesus advised his people to flee to the mountains. 3 days, which means 3 years, until Jesus returns? It's possible. And then the 2 men returned to Joshua, without a negative report this time. Israel is ready to cross the Jordan River and take the land Jericho. And then the Israelites picked up the Ark of the Covenant, walked full of faith to the borders of the Jordan River. And God opened the river. Scripture tells us that God stopped the flowing Jordan. The water moved down and up to a town called Adam, next to Sarathen, a town next to it. And Jordan means to descend and to judge. When the Israelites crossed the Jordan, Jesus descended. He touched the water. He took the judgment for us, the guilt for our sins. And he rolled the water back to Adam. And how about the town called Sarathen? Sarathen is the Hebrew word for piercing. He was pierced for all of us. There's nothing without a reason in the Bible. 40 years earlier, the Lord first parted the Red Sea before they walked. But this time, they first walked and then God departed the Jordan. When they all passed the Jordan, God commanded Joshua to take 12 men, one from each tribe, collect 12 stones from the Jordan River and make a memorial sign. 12 stones, as a memorial to the Jordan miracle. The Hebrew word is oath. Interestingly, the same word that is used for rainbow after the flood in Genesis. And the same word used for circumcision. When the Israelites are near to Jericho, Joshua sees a mysterious man in front of him, with a sword and ready to fight. And Joshua asks, "Are you for us or are you enemy?" When he says, "I am the commander of the army of the Lord," Joshua falls down on the ground, realizing that he is in the presence of the Lord. And Joshua asks him what to do. "Take off your sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy." Remember Moses? God talking from the burning bush. This is Joshua's burning bush moment. Here God commands Joshua to march with all people around the city. How many times? Most people will say 7 times, but it is 13 times. One time for 6 days and the last day 7 times. In front of the parade, 7 priests with 7 shofars in front of the Ark of the Covenant. And behind them, soldiers, an army of over 1 million people, only marching, no further sound. And the first 6 days, just one time, and then they return to their camp. Can you imagine this sound of millions marching boots around the city? No further sound, except the shofars. It must have drove the people of Jericho crazy. But wait a minute. The people marched 6 times and then 7 times, right? Could it be that the first 6 days represent the 6 seals in Revelation? Could it be that the last day, 7 times, represent the 7 tribulation years, the final 7 years? Could it be that Jericho represents this pagan world that in the last days will be destroyed? Jericho, the center of occult worship, worshipping ourselves, our money, our proud thoughts. Jesus, who will defeat this world system in the 70th week of Daniel, the final 7th trumpet blast. I think it's possible. In both stories, Joshua and Revelation, there are 7 trumpets. In both stories, there are 2 spies or witnesses. In both stories, there is a harlot. And in both stories, there is a city with walls. And in both stories, there's a final shout. So what did Rahab do in the meantime? Question. What would we do? Rahab was doing all she could to bring in people into her house to save them. This is the works that Jesus is talking about. Works? Why do we need works? We have our faith, right? And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works, when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body, apart from the spirit, is dead, so also faith, apart from works, is dead. Scripture teaches us that faith without works is dead. We are in the final stage of the 2000 years that Jesus returns, Joshua, to save Rahab's house and destroy Jericho. This is what the two spies told Rahab. Start with your own family and friends. To connect with your tribe, with us, with Zebulun or any other apostolic center or church sharing the same vision. We all need to be in Rahab's house when Jesus returns. Remember the story of Noah, where people were probably knocking at the ark after God closed it and the water came? Remember the story of the 10 virgins, where the 5 foolish virgins didn't prepare themselves and the door was closed when they returned? They completely missed to be on time in Rahab's house. Not because they were stupid or non-believers, no. Because they didn't believe it was going to happen in their lives. Therefore, they didn't prepare themselves. And at the 7th time, when the priest blew the trumpets, Joshua said to the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the city. But the city shall be designated for destruction. It and everything that's in it belongs to the Lord. Only Rahab, the prostitute, and all who are with her in the house shall live, because she hid the messengers whom we sent." And then the final 7th day. They marched around the city 7 times. And the 7th time, when the priest blew the final shofar sound, the people shouted, and all the walls came down. After the walls fell down, the soldiers went up into the city and they took it. They destroyed everything in the city. Both men, women, young, old, axe, sheep, donkey, with the edge of the sword. Wonderful and promised by God, Rahab's house was still intact, untouched, still standing. Why? Because of Rahab's faith and works. Rahab had faith and hang a scarlet rope out of her window as a sign of the covenant. Same as the blood on the doorpost 40 years earlier during Passover, saved from the angel of death. Why a scarlet rope? And when she was in labor, one put out a hand, and the midwife took and tied a scarlet thread on his hand, saying, "This one came out first." The firstborn in scripture refers not to birth order, but to rank. The firstborn possessed the inheritance as and leadership. Therefore, the phrase firstborn expresses Christ's sovereignty over creation. After resurrecting Jesus from the dead, God gave him authority over the earth. In other words, scarlet, which stands for royal, and rope, stand for Jesus. And Solomon, the father of Boaz, by Rahab. And Boaz, the father of Obed, by Ruth. And Obed, the father of Jesse. And Jesse, the father of David, the king. God blessed Rahab. She became the great-great-grandmother of King David. Rahab's house, by the way, is still standing today as a testimony, as a sign. So what did we learn and what does this all mean for us today? Joshua. We learned that Joshua and Jericho clearly foreshadow Jesus' second coming. Joshua, a shadow of the coming Savior, and Jesus as the fulfillment of what Joshua was picturing. Remember the mysterious man that Joshua met and Joshua fell down on the ground, asking him to take off his sandals because of holy ground. I believe that this was Jesus. This story, for those who follow us weekly know, this story is another example of a clear Old Testament key to help us understand what is coming in the near future. The walls came down based on faith. And this is the courageous faith that God asks us in this day, today, and the days to come, in this last season. So when is this near future? At the end of day 6. At the end of 6,000 years. Before the day 7, the Shabbat day, the millennium Shabbat of 1,000 years. At the end of the 2,000 years after Jesus ascended to heaven. But last season, end times? Ah, there's no end time now. People are talking about end times since the Second World War. It's not happening now. We don't need to prepare. It will happen, for sure. But not in my days. No way. We understand that it's not easy to understand, and it also counts for us, but I have a few questions. Is Joshua, Jesus, coming a second time? Are there shofars going to be blown? Will there be a destruction of Jericho, the world? Will it be wise to prepare? To prepare for the worst and hope for the best? But where to start? Start sharing our weekly messages, our weekly video to your family, to your friends. They deserve this. They deserve our shout, our Jericho shout. I believe it's time to bring as many people as possible out of their Noah's days flow and convince them and bring them into Rahab's house. Have a blessed week. Shabbat Shalom.